Hi everyone, thanks for tuning into this CNCF maintainer track session. This is about OpenEVS, a CNCF project, and we'll try to introduce OpenEVS, the rationale behind developing it, as well as try to get into a few more details in terms of architecture and how we benchmark the different engines available in OpenEVS. I'm joined today with Vishnu. Both of us work at MyData. We are very active in the Kubernetes Slack. You know, through this session, or like, you know, if you have any questions related to running stateful workloads, please feel free to reach out. We are available on Twitter as well. I don't know if you all are aware of MyData, but you must have definitely heard about some of the projects that we do, like OpenEVS, and most recently it's Litmus Chaos, which also has become a CNCF project. Incidentally, because of our contributions, we are among the top five companies that contribute to CNCF. We are a pretty small startup with a lot of CKAs that work within the organization. So in terms of the work we do, we are highly focused on Kubernetes itself while working on OpenEVS and Litmus as the primary projects. We also contribute to a lot of ecosystem projects like Kubernetes itself, or like, you know, also managing the NFS project that's within the Kubernetes purview. And like Vita here is also a contributor to Valero, which we will talk a little bit more as we go along. OpenEVS itself has seen a tremendous growth and popularity in the last few years. As you can see from the recent Twitter poll, it kind of ranks among the top container attached storage options that people are evaluating for running stateful workloads in Kubernetes. So we have a packed agenda today, so I'll try to go rather quickly through some of these topics. The rough outline would be briefly introduce the state of stateful workloads in Kubernetes. What does Kubernetes really provide? And then introduce the reasoning behind why a new way of developing the storage is required, what we call as container attached storage. And for any project to succeed, you eventually end up like comparing with what is already available to what's coming new. So we will present some benchmarking numbers, and followed by few best practices around how people are using OpenEVS for running stateful workloads, and some of the challenges associated when we don't run with it as well, right? Jumping right in, so this kind of gives a snapshot of the main concepts in Kubernetes that help with stateful workloads. If you are just getting started with stateful workloads, all you need to know is persistent volume claim, storage class, and CSI. But for many of us who have been around for a while, this has been a journey in terms of evolving from having all the storage providers within Kubernetes, and even in terms of constructs, changing from volume to entry volumes, flex volumes, and most recently external provisioner volumes as well. We kind of refer to this a little bit more going forward, but this is really Conway's law at play, where having all the storage drivers within the Kubernetes actually slowed down the development of Kubernetes itself, because you cannot like possibly make sure all the drivers, all the supported drivers are always stable, or it kind of maintains the release cadence of Kubernetes. So CSI kind of became a de facto standard for kind of developing the storages independently and attaching to the stateful workloads in Kubernetes. It's still an evolving process. There are a lot of new concepts that are in different stages of maturity. For example, like how do you actually schedule workloads based on the requirements that come from the storage, or how do you populate a volume before actually giving it to the workload? The concept of pools itself are all like evolving. So if you are interested in contributing to any of this, or you have ideas on how to do this, or you have some use cases that need this, please join the Kubernetes Six Storage community calls, or like one of the working group calls. We are always looking for help to improve and evolve this one. Talking about CSI is an interesting thing. Many people who are getting started with stateful workloads tend to see that CSI is like the end game, but we have to realize that CSI is just the beginning. So with CSI, people tend to use this architecture where they connect their workloads to an external storage via CSI. This could be like a good stepping stone into the stateful workloads with Kubernetes, but this comes with a lot of challenges. In fact, like if you dig deep into, or like, you know, think for a minute on how this architecture is deployed, you have a microservices architecture where a lot of loosely coupled applications are writing data via CSI into a monolithic system. The enterprise SANs that are depicted here are those that have been developed for working with VMs or like, you know, physical servers, which are really optimized for the hardware that was available when they were developed, as well as the workload demands in terms of scale out, or like, you know, in terms of like larger capacity and high intensive workloads that basically write into that. This kind of defeats the purpose of microservices architecture, as we'll see a little bit. So one of the primary principle is loosely coupled architecture. In this case, IOs from all the applications are going to the same system, and that system is trying to manage in terms of providing the optimal path for these applications. And there's a significantly higher chance of hitting noisy neighbor, or like, you know, lot of issues in terms of shared storage going down, bringing down all the applications. If you look at the CNCF survey, which kind of reflects that, you know, that way of communicating to the storage or connecting is not the only option. There are different options that are being tried out. To highlight, OpenEBS and Portbox are a couple of them, which follow the container attached storage pattern. So one thing about this survey that's pretty interesting is, you know, CSI is also treated as a storage, which it is not. I think we have to be clear about that. And then the worker nodes itself consume some amount of storage. So some of the cloud volumes that are present here are probably those that just provide storage to the worker nodes. But some specific projects like Ceph, Gluster, or like OpenEBS and Portworx, these are all examples of applications that run within Kubernetes that actually provide storage only to stateful workloads. So we'll see why there is this rise in popularity of evaluating this container attached storage in the Kubernetes stateful workloads world. So before we that, I think I just briefly mentioned Conway's law. It's very important to kind of ingest this concept, especially in today's world where this a cultural shift that's taken place. It's called DevOps, but it just doesn't stop at the CI/CD or developing and fast, you know, pushing it into production at a much, much higher frequency rather than how you develop the system. It's a kind of like, you know, you are breaking down the silos within your organization to form functional teams that are loosely coupled. Each functional team is tasked with a goal of developing a certain service, and everything else is exposed via API that can be taken up by some other team. And the interfaces are like clearly defined to independently evolve, right? This is what makes the shift from monolithic to microservices architecture tick in terms of faster development and agility. So what about the data? To learn if there has to be any change, I think this is a good video from a CNCF end user, in this case, Steven Bower at Bloomberg. This is actually a financial or like a market analysis company, but then all of these companies are not just in their domain. They are also software companies. They employ a lot of technologists or like, you know, engineers. So in this case, Steven Bower talks about how his small team of platform engineers supports like thousands of engineers who are all like small autonomous teams developing distributed applications. And the key thing is automation and loosely coupling of these teams, which is actually enabled by making sure none of these teams are running on a shared platform. Kubernetes kind of enables that. You kind of use this hardware to design a platform where multiple teams are kind of deploying their applications in an isolated way with clearly defined interfaces. If you click on the links that are kind of pointed towards a certain time frame, you kind of listen how the loosely coupling of the teams are coming down even to the storage layer. The data also has to be distributed. This diagram from ThoughtWorks that kind of explains the Conway's law for data management also is a great representation. So just like the monolithic middleware tier systems are getting split into microservices, even the databases are splitting into multiple smaller databases. In fact, like what this gives is freedom for the developers to pick the right database to use for their application demands rather than trying to force fit their needs into a database that is managed, maybe because, like, you know, that's the only database administrators that they have, or, like, you know, it takes a lot of time to introduce a database into the environment. The freedom that microservices and the new cultural shift with small teams bring is each team is capable of picking up the right tools for delivering their service. So the loosely coupled nature has to percolate down from the teams to application architecture, even to the data management, which data management, again, like, kind of uses the underlying storage. And if the underlying storage is monolithic, it ends up making sure that the applications themselves try to rewrite the databases or, like, the storage systems on which they want to deploy their data. This is definitely happening as some of these systems like Cassandra or, like, you know, even MongoDB are all working on local PV instead of, like, using a shared storage platform. So the aversion or, like, you know, the need to go away from this kind of a monolithic architecture for storage is the first one is the challenge of data gravity, which can be defined as this notion where the storage systems tends to pull in all the applications that are using it towards them. This could be because of the amount of data that we write into it, and it kind of becomes harder to get away, or, you know, it's also like, you know, the further away you are from the storage system, the latency and increases, and which kind of impacts the performance of the applications. And as the data grows, which is actually directly related to the amount of cost for maintaining that infrastructure, as well as you kind of locked in so that you don't, you have to pay a huge amount of migration costs in case you want to move to a different, better solution later on. While the architecture itself has those challenges, I think in tandem, like, there are a lot of things that are happening in the hardware and software patterns, or, like, you know, how the evolution in those fields that require you to rewrite some parts of the software. For example, like in this case, we are showing that there's been an increase in the number of cores that are available per system because of the technological advancements in the transistor technology. So this box here from Supermicro kind of shows that you can pack up to 96 cores and 1 TB flash drive. The thing about this evolved hardware is you can't take a system that was developed to run on 8 to 16 core and try to expect it to give a better performance. You actually need to use some newer trends, which comes down to, like, rewriting the software. For example, one of the things that you probably want to do is you don't want to use SCSI as a layer to transport the data, which kind of peaks at 1K. Transactions that can run in parallel versus NVMe that can support up to 64K transactions. And also the flexibility that you get with NVMe, where you can completely bypass the kernel by writing a small driver. You know, the number of commands that you need to implement for NVMe are much shorter than the ones that you have to write for bypassing the kernel. Right? So DPTK and NVMe technologies have made it easier for people to start benefiting from the powerful hardware that we have. And similarly, I think this is, like, an interesting trend that comes from Brendan Gregg about the impact of the system calls on the performance of the system, which kind of shows that beyond, like, 5 calls, you tend to increase the impact. And one of the possibilities that we have now is avoid actually going through the kernel and system calls and try to directly make use of the user space programs directly accessing the hardware, which is a reality now, right? There's definitely one way, and huge pages is another way of accessing or, like, making things faster. Change in terms of, like, you know, Linux kernel also supporting new mechanisms in which you can make use of this better hardware. the AIO way of processing the IOs can actually peak or like, you know, saturate once you cross, once you reach the boundary of 8 cores. So IOU ring or IOU ring pool may be the ways to kind of implement your, to increase the transactions of performing it at scale. This has been adopted in all the parallel technologies. It's not just about storage that we're talking here. If you look at the distributed database like ScalaDB, which is a variant of Cassandra, or like, you know, networking counterparts like BBB or OpenSwitch, they have all realized that by to make use of the better hardware, to get away from the lock contentions that increase the latency and reduce the number of transactions you can run, you have to use the Polmo driver, spin the core, and increase the performance. This is exactly what we did in OpenEBS as part of our Open MyStore engine efforts, which we'll see in a bit. So hardware and software are changing, and so are the culture and processes and the way the applications are developed, and we have to change the storage. And if we don't change the storage, these are like few challenges. So you get locked into basically longer cycles, and the benefits that you get of distributed architecture kind of contradict by putting all of those data in. And the thing that I did not mention earlier or around the origin, GitOps has gained a lot of popularity with the rise in making use of Kubernetes as a platform for delivering your infrastructure and application services. This is a notion where you treat your infrastructure and the deployments as code, and you can kind of put in the processes of reviews and merges and then automatically deploy or even roll back. This kind of becomes difficult when you're using a system that was not developed with these declarative intents. You know, any number of thin layers cannot possibly get you that same notion. It's also about, you know, the better hardware, like, you know, how are you effectively using it? Are you making use of the latest patterns to fully utilize the power that your hardware or like, you know, the infrastructure that you have invested in can provide you, right? So just to summarize, changes that are happening around, which are eventually forcing the storage to be rewritten, are around the changes in the language itself, software languages. For example, like, you know, there are meta languages that are on the rise, like Ballerina or Metaparticle, that allow you to develop applications with an ML-like language. And Rust, on the other hand, like, you know, allows you to write powerful user space programs that operate at the kernel speeds with better concurrency constructs. The apps are being rewritten, for example, to make use of these constructs. Like, for example, if you look at the recent blog from CNCF, Rust at CNCF, that details how, for example, like Linkerd has benefited, and there are some other articles around, like, you know, how MinIO is being rewritten in Rust to kind of gain the higher performance as well, right? In fact, like, these are not just about rewriting, they're also being re-architected to make use of the benefits that Kubernetes has to offer. I think Cassandra is another example where if you check the roadmap, you kind of tend to see that there are a lot of enhancements planned to help Cassandra run better within Kubernetes. So these applications themselves are distributed. These are what we call as cloud native apps that can automatically scale, sustain single node failures. It kind of brings to question, like, you know, do we really need to depend on high availability features in storage, right? So, or is there like some different way in which we can provide the storage to these, a complementary storage solution to these applications, right? At the end of it, it's all the agility that drives how fast can you innovate by using the infrastructure that you have at your disposal is what drives all these changes. To quickly recap on the changes that are happening at the workload or high load demands, that like we have seen the data management taking on the Conway's law is breaking down from monolithic to smaller databases. And this I can confirm with my interactions with the community members were like 100 TB databases are now kind of getting split into 1 TB, 100 different volumes serving data for 1 TB per user kind of an architecture. That breakdown is happening, which basically means that you need lower capacity volumes with lower I/O, but at a very large scale. And hardware trends are actually forcing almost all the technology stacks to be rewritten, and storage is no different. So here are some examples of the users that have actually realized that this change is happening. These are like Power Kubernetes users, if the way I call them. These are the folks that have adopted Kubernetes at an early stage. They have like automations in place to build their own Kubernetes flavor by pulling in the upstream Kubernetes. And then pretty much they kind of run most of their stateful workloads in Kubernetes already. The key thing with this particular user is they do not want to use another distributed file system. Rather, they basically want to make use of the resiliency that these applications themselves provide. So they're making use of OpenAV's ZFS local PV in this case, which basically gives you the benefit of accessing the storage locally on the node with high low latency, as well as allows you to maintain some kind of a storage lifecycle in terms of resiliency against the disk failures, or like, you know, ability to do better snapshot transfers at a block layer, right? This is another example of, that was an end user, and this is an example of a database practitioner or a partner or a consultant who helps people run Postgres kind of databases. You can see from this great blog article that running within Kubernetes can still provide you with the same performance or like the scale numbers. Do go through this article. It has great references, and incidentally, this also uses OpenAVS local PV, which is a slight variant of what is already available in Kubernetes, especially in terms of dynamic provisioning of local PVs and managing the lifecycle of those PVs. A huge list of adopters that have listed here, especially even though I kind of call them as OpenAVS adopters, these are really adopters who have taken the stateful workloads into Kubernetes, and these are like really early adopters, and they're already running a lot of stuff in production. So CAS, container attached storage, is the pattern in which you bring the Conway slot to the storage, break down the monolithic storage systems into a microservices-based architecture. You know, it's not just a unified storage that provides all the access, rather like it's different set of engines. The cloud native apps are changing, and each app can actually pick up the right engine for delivering the storage needs. And each, the workloads are not tied into some shared storage. You can kind of move the systems in an isolated way. For example, each workload can move by itself to a different set of nodes or a different cluster or a different AZ and all that. The cool thing about CAS, or like, you know, this in specific OpenAVS here, is it's open source. You can kind of, there's no lock-in into OpenAVS as well. Everything is very transparent. You can kind of decide if you want to move away from OpenAVS. It also makes it easier to do that. We talk a little bit more about this cloud native apps and how they're using this container attached storage. So I kind of show a couple of examples here of two different engines at use. This is a case where the application itself is distributed. You can consider this as an example of MongoDB, which is typically deployed as a stateful set, and each replica pod tries to get its own volume. The only requirement here is, you know, if a node goes down momentarily, when it comes back, it can actually get scheduled on the same node so that it does not have to rebuild the entire data. But even if that node completely goes down, it can spin up a new replica, and a new local volume can get provisioned, and then the data can be rebuilt by using the other two application pods. So the different ways in which local PV can be provisioned, host pod is hugely popular, and then we have like raw block device, and then ZFS or like LVM as another option. The reason we have like all these various options is it totally depends on the way your worker nodes are created and the length of the stateful workloads that run within the cluster. For example, like there are stateful workloads, especially as part of the ML pipelines, that just run for 15-20 minutes, and you don't really need like a durable storage for that. So you kind of go with like a host path of, if you want low latency, you go with local PV device. But there may be some projects like Postgres that or MongoDB that save your user data, and you need some kind of a larger resiliency, and those can actually benefit from the COW capabilities that copy and write capabilities that the ZFS pools provide, and also like the protection against the disk errors that comes in built with ZFS. So the other classification in which you choose these different local PVs is the number of devices that are available on the nodes itself. So Kubernetes is now offered on several hundreds of different types of managed service platforms, as well as custom commodity hardwares. And your worker nodes can come with the different configurations. Some can come with like almost like no storage, or like, you know, the storage only that's available on the OS disk. These are like good candidates for using a host path based local PV versus like, you know, nodes that come with some additional drives, but maybe like, you know, you need to protect against the disk rot or things like that. This is where like ZFS local PV comes. And another cool thing about ZFS local PV is the block level snapshot migration that you can get, as well as a dynamic expansion by adding additional disks into the ZFS pool. In fact, like thin provisioning is also another use case why people go for ZFS local PV. The other one, especially if you want to run a fleet of large number of servers, maybe like a Solar instance or things like that, you want dedicated disks on the nodes, you go with the local PV raw device. So, you know, I kind of use a lot of local PV terms here. One common denominator here is NDM, which is a core component of OpenVS that can be actually installed separately as well, which allows you to monitor your storage from the device, just like any other Kubernetes resource. The block device is a resource that OpenVS implements. You can get the different properties, and you can see which block device is used by which application or storage engine. Okay, so the other kind of applications, you know, these are probably some, for example, like if you're trying to run GitLab and maybe like your Vitali server is not distributed by itself, that can be, that can kind of use the replicated functionality that's available with storage engines like CStore or like MyStore or Jiva. Each of these Vitali kind of applications can get its own storage controller. Instead of using a shared storage controller, you use a dedicated storage controller or like a micro storage controller that takes the IOs, performs the data services, and then also takes care of replicating the data to different nodes. In case the node on which the Vitali server or the target is running have been lost or rebooted, these are all like Kubernetes pods that gets rescheduled to a different node, and the target will connect to the remaining available replicas and serve the data. So these are this kind of gets into a little bit more details into the CStore. So the CStore itself is a pod that runs within the OpenVS namespace, and it kind of can aggregate a number of disks into a pool, and there could be multiple replicas that are scheduled on that one. Or you can decide to, depending on the hardware that you have, you can create multiple CStore pools and also kind of you provide a different class of service for your applications. This goes into a little bit of IO path that is followed by the CStore. In this case, one conscious decision we did when we started off OpenVS is to make use of iSCSI as an access protocol for CStore. That, you know, this was like 3.5 years ago when NVMe was still catching up, and it was not readily available in all the cloud platforms or like, you know, as a commodity hardware. iSCSI was chosen mainly to make sure that when users are adopting the Kubernetes as a platform for stateful workloads. They don't have to do any special things in the Linux kernel to get things going. In that way, it has definitely paid off. So the PV or like the application mounts the I2C storage, and the I2C storage is it's part of the target, a CStore target that in turn writes the data to CStore pools. The CStore pools itself can write the data to any of the devices that are available. The reason that I also mentioned this is like, you know, MyStore kind of follows a different architecture compared to this, where we support I2C, but also support different types of backends and even frontends. NVMe is one of them, especially to eliminate or like, you know, meet the low latency demands. Right. So another thing with using NVMe along with the fast, it's the number of, you know, the layers that have reduced, which kind of increased the speed for low latency workloads. MyStore is at 2.0.2.0 in an alpha stage right now. You can kind of try it out and help us by providing the feedback. MyStore also is fully implemented in user space. And when we talk about user space, we kind of tend to think, you know, how does it perform in terms of IO ops? We will see that in a little bit. The target here, we call it as Nexus, which is basically used to replicate the data to different backends. The backends could be accessed via NBD or like, you know, it could be over I2C or NVMe over Fabric. This also is a way or like a solution that allows you to kind of migrate the data or hydrate the data out of the cluster as well. The Nexus also plays an important role in securing your data. It can add the encryption layer, and without the Nexus, or you know, without basically, you can kind of use products like Vault, etc., to kind of set the keys to Nexus, which without which you cannot access the data. One of the things that we continue to follow in all of the engines that we provide is the declarative way of managing, which is basically like the Kubernetes native way of managing your infrastructure and application pods. So just to reiterate that if you are a Kubernetes administrator or if you know how to run applications in Kubernetes, you know how to run OpenAVS. It's as simple as that. So speaking of benchmarking, since we run in user space and we kind of have this limitations at the OS driver level, how do we fare? We took the help of an independent partner, Octane. Octane itself is also working on solving the cost-related challenges within Kubernetes. So I highly recommend you to go check that their work at GetOctane. So the tools that are used for benchmarking here are FIVO and PGBench, and the scripts that are used are all open sourced at the performance benchmark GitHub repository that's listed here. One thing to note here is we are not tuning any of these storage engines or the applications for better performance. I think this is a conscious decision, since many of the users actually run the performance tests with the default, or in fact, like, we don't expect a specialized storage admin to run OpenAVS. So it's mostly developers who don't probably need to know anything about storage. For them, storage just has to work. But if you are like an experienced storage user, and you probably already know this, there are different ways in which you can tune the I2C itself to get better performance. One thing to note with the performance, especially in terms of cloud native world, is that it's not how you drive a single volume, but how you can scale up the volumes using the underlying hardware, and how do they perform when you're introducing chaos like a node failure or like the system's failure, and how does your scaled applications interact in that situation.
And just one point there to add, Kiran, is about the edge devices also, like coming up now with the limited resources or the node level, having a Kubernetes cluster among them. I mean,
absolutely,
it's kind of on the edge how the OpenAVS less footprint and less requirement, hardware requirements will help.
Yeah, that's a great point. And thanks to a lot of community members from China who have helped us to enable the ARM builds on some of these engines. So thanks to them, we actually have a variant of OpenVS that can be installed on ARM 64 clusters as well. Cool. So this kind of shows the Postgres benchmarking results. I won't get into a lot of details. We recently did a CNCF webinar where we talk about this a little more. But it suffices to say that what we see here is the comparison between running directly on host path or a device versus running with CStore. In this case, CStore is still using iSCSI, but it basically uses the pole mode driver to drive up the performance. Whereas CStore is mostly an ZFS porting to user space and uses the iSCSI. So as expected, I think because of those various layers, the performance there is low, as it does not use these native concepts for enhancing the performance that we have incorporated into CStore. One thing though about the performance is, especially with the CStore, we kind of see the throughput is less. But if you compare the IOPS numbers of this CStore, those are like comparable to some of the IOPS that the cloud native volumes offer. And this is one of the primary reasons why many of the applications, for example, like there are cases where there are 50 workloads in a three node cluster running on a CStore engine, and the customers are really happy with the performance they get out of that. It totally depends on the use case as well as like the nature of the IOs that you are performing. Most of the times it could be for reads which where the cache can come into play, as well as the number of writes could be much less. But in case of the benchmarking test, we try to stress on the negative scenarios, so the numbers seem really low. Right. Do check out the OpenVS adopters for checking all the applications that end users are using with CStore as well. So we spoke about high availability, we spoke about benchmarks, and we spoke about what's the right way to perform the storage, using container at storage. But all of this kind of run within Kubernetes environment. Now, what about that whole Kubernetes environment itself is gone, and that's what leads us into data protection. And I'll probably let Vishnu speak a little more on this one. He's been actively contributing to Valero, which is the product that we use to integrate provide us with the data protection capabilities. Vishnu, over to you.
Thanks, Kiran. That's a really breathtaking session on the CAS architecture and how the Kubernetes story is evolving. Thanks for that. And so given all the features like replication, the storage level snapshotting, all this given at the storage layer, the data has to be protected in some location outside of the cluster and makes it like resilient for any cloud failure, for any cluster failures. And also at the same time, you want to migrate the data from one cluster to another cluster. So that's where OpenVS, its volumes with the help of Valero, which is a wonderful open source project, which allows to takes the backup of the entire application along with the YAMLs, and then at the same time have the plugin approach for taking the backup of the data. And this same way, the destination cluster, it allows to restore the data. So here, OpenVS have the Valero plugins, which takes the backups, the snapshots, the backups at very incremental level, and also takes a full backup. So using the again ZFS snapshotting capabilities, and it also allows you to take the point in snapshots locally also and clone it with a different namespace as well. So these are the plugins available for the OpenVS volumes, and it sends the data, it backs up data to the it backs up data to the S3 location. Then it allows to restore from the S3 location. The next slide here I want to explain is about the Kubera, which is a the commercial version of OpenVS. One of the commercial version of OpenVS available allows you to do provision the volumes, understand the detect the disk attached to the node, and it provides the multiple productions, data production services at the same time. Allows, it shows the topology of the the storage pools creates and the application analytics as well it provides commercial about the OpenABS project. The next slide. So here I want to go through the overview. So as Kiran explained, like we have NDM as the one of the piece which does conversion of this hardware attached to the node, that is a storage device, a storage disk, into the Kubernetes YAMLs. And this allows us to make a declarative data plane for the declarative control plane for all the OpenABS engines. So if you see, the first layer is about the cluster components here. These are the kind of deployments or stateful sets which can run anywhere in the cluster. So here we have the OpenABS operator, which talks about, which does the provisioning part, and NDM operator detects the which will allow to claim the disk block devices attached to the node. The CSA controllers for the various OpenABS volumes, we have the controllers available, and the Volero as a service itself, as a server, runs as a deployment which anywhere in the cluster. At the node level, we have the daemon set for NDM, which allows to take the which converts the disk attached to the node into YAMLs. And then we have few node level components where the sysstore pools and the GVAR replicas, which will run within the node wherever the disk are attached. And these are like available at every node in the cluster. Next slide. So here the provisioning comes where the cluster admin sets up the OpenABS by creating the storage pool client, which is nothing but a pool of disk has been made and over which the sysstore volumes can be provisioned. So he creates the storage classes as well, which allows to applications to consume these storage classes in this PVC YAMLs. So that is that's a level at which a cluster admin does a setup of the hardware. And then the users, the developers will start writing the application YAMLs with the PVCs pointing to this state, to these storage classes, and the control plane of the OpenABS, that is the OpenABS provision, comes into the picture and creates the replicas in various available nodes as per the configuration done by the cluster admin. So this can be used for the applications which want the replication and snapshotting functionality from the storage layer. Next slide. This slide talks about where again the administrator sets up storage classes which are related, which doesn't provide the replication but actually provides the high availability, high performance to the level of the disk. Once he creates the storage classes, then again applications which are having its own replication technology can use these storage classes to create the PVs and then the storage will attach to these volumes to these applications. Next slide. So with this, I hand over to Kiran to go through the next slides available.
I hope Vishnu and I have convinced you that it's kind of very easy to run stateful workloads using OpenABS. It's a simple process you just start installing OpenABS with Helm commands or like an operator, and then it's very easy to kind of set up the storage classes for OpenABS. The reasons for you to kind of evaluate OpenABS or use OpenABS for your stateful workloads, kind of recapping on the CAS advantages, is you get this portability across different platforms. It could be on-prem or cloud, and it's an open storage platform which is completely Apache licensed, and it's designed for the NVMe architecture, and it avoids the lock-in, which kind of directly relates to the data gravity issues that we kind of talked about, and then better return on investments. It's not just about your storage costs, but it's also the operational overhead that you will have for maintaining a pet storage product versus a system that can be managed by your Kubernetes SREs directly. And then your you don't have like a different system to manage OpenAVS works on by making use of the storage that's available on the Kubernetes nodes itself, just like how you're networking or like, you know, you probably use Calico or other CNI plugins to manage your network that's available on the Kubernetes worker nodes, the same way you can use OpenAVS to manage the storage on those worker nodes. The blast radius is a key aspect that you should definitely consider, especially when you're running thousands of microservices in Kubernetes clusters. You don't want the failures in the storage, which are bound to happen at some point, to impact all of your services. As much as possible, you need to work towards reducing the blast radius, and OpenAVS helps you, and CAS in general helps you to make sure that the blast radius is kind of limited to the workload that is running on that particular storage engine, instead of like impacting everything that you that happens when you use a shared storage layer. So this also enables you to form loosely coupled teams. In fact, like, you know, the developers can get the feel of how the stateful workloads run on OpenAVS storage in the same way it does, just like how you how Docker and Kubernetes has changed the way people develop and think about applications storage. OpenAVS changes the way you think about stateful workloads. And the key aspect is the declarative way of doing things. I think, you know, we need to keep reiterating that it's the reconciliation loops that get implemented and automated in an async way that can now go from your applications to all the way to the storage. Here are some references for you to get started. The OpenAVS I/O has a list of all the references, reference applications, as well as the users. Docs are a great way to start. If you have any issues, you can reach out to us over the Slack or the GitHub. And if you are already using OpenAVS, we are at this stage in the project where we are applying for incubation. So if you want to share and enable other users to use OpenAVS, please share your story on the adopters.md. The link for that is available at the end in this list. With that, we conclude this session. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to present at the China KubeCon. We hope to do this in person in the coming years. Thanks again.
Thank you.